Happy Mother's Day, mothers. It's good to be with you. I'm so thankful for my mom today, who, one, she dealt with me for way too many years, but she's also the one who grew me up in my faith and was always pointing me back to God. She was such a strong Christian woman, always praying for me, and so I'm so thankful for her. And today really is a celebration for our mothers, and even though, you know, like every day should be a celebration of our moms, right? Amen? Amen. It should be. But today is a special celebration for our moms, and today is also a day, though, that brings some in our church deep sadness. Those who have lost their mothers, mothers who have lost a child, those who desire so much to be mothers, it can be a pretty complicated day for them. And so I don't want to diminish either of those feelings today. I want to maximize both of them, celebration and grief. The scripture actually tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep. And so as a church, I think that we can do both of those things together today to their fullest extent. And so whether today is a day of celebration for you or a day of complex sadness, please know that as a church, we see you and we love you and we rejoice with you and we weep with you. Let me pray for our mothers before we jump in. God, we're so thankful for our moms and how you've used them in our lives to grow us. And Lord, we're just so grateful for their guidance and for their care and love for us. And Lord, we just pray today that they would feel so blessed, that they would feel so recognized and celebrated and loved by their families. And God, what an important role a mother is in a child's life. And so, Lord, we're thankful for how you have created us and who you've created mothers to be. And Lord, help us to celebrate them well today. And Lord, we're also mindful of those where today is just a difficult reminder. Lord, would we grieve with them? Would we weep with them? And would you, most importantly, Lord, would you be near them today? Would you comfort them? Would you be their strength? We love you, Lord. We're thankful for our moms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, if you're new, my name's Tommy Kreitz. I get to serve as the campus pastor here at Harvest Crystal Lake, and I have the privilege of bringing God's word to us today. So you're going to need a Bible, whether that is the physical copy or an electronic version of it. We need to get our eyes on God's word. I hope you bring your Bible every single week. In fact, let's do a check. I'm just kidding. We're not going to do a check. if you don't have one, we actually have some at the bottom of the seats, right underneath the seat. There's a Bible for you. And if you don't own one, that one's for you. We want you to have that as a gift. We want you to have a copy of God's word to have in your hands and in your heart. Today, we're going to be in Isaiah chapter 43. Verses 1 through 2. So we're kind of in the middle of two series, right? We just finished 1 Corinthians. Next week, we're going to be jumping into a short series on Jonah. And so this week, though, this is a verse that has meant so much to me for so long, and I wanted to bring it to all of you. Isaiah 43, 1 and 2. Not a lot of verses today, but a lot in there for us. And the title of today is Fear Not. Fear Not. Probably one of my biggest fears is spiders. Anyone else with me on that? Spiders? Anyone else just like, I can't stand it. Not like every time my wife is like, babe, please come down, get this spider, get it. I dread that moment. Okay? There's a battle that happens in my heart of just, I want to do my duty, right, as a husband and protect my wife, but I don't want my hand anywhere near that disgusting eight-legged creature, you know what I mean? You go to get it, what if it jumps on you? It's over when that happens, and that is the reason that I have that fear. Like, I'm not afraid of snakes or sharks or clowns or anything like that, but I am afraid of spiders. And the reason I think that I'm so afraid of spiders is because as a young man, I lived in Wisconsin. And what you do in Wisconsin when there's nothing to do is you run around in cornfields, okay? I don't know why. That's what we did. And so me and a couple of friends, we were playing tag or something in a cornfield. And what else happens in cornfields is that spiders make their web across the stalks. And a very particular spider makes their web across corn stalks, and that's called the banana spider. If you've ever seen one of those, black and yellow, humongous. I feel like crawling on me right now, you know what I mean? Oh. And so as a kid, I'm running through, having the time of my life, running through this cornfield, and I run into a spider's web. Now, it wasn't on some convenient place, like my chest, covered by my clothes, or on my hands or my arms, but I could quickly do this. But it was right on my face. I ran through a spider's web with my face, and the spider was on my face. The banana spider, right here, on my face. And it bit me on my head. And that's probably why I have such a small forehead. It messed me up. I don't know what happened. Kelly says that I have a 3 head. I don't know what that means, but... And ever since that moment, I've been afraid of spiders. I absolutely can't stand them. That is a fear that I have. That's not the type of fear that we're talking about today, right? That kind of funny, shallow, sort of real, not really real fear, right? What we're going to be exploring today is the deep-rooted fears, and we're going to be transparent about that and what we really actually fear. So I said spiders were my biggest fear. That's not true. My actual biggest fear is the fear of failure. It's the fear of failure. In fact, no other perfect example than what I'm doing right now in preaching God's word. You need to know that all week I have been afraid. And the moment that I was sitting there worshiping, there were moments where I was overcome with fear of getting up and speaking, and maybe some of you can relate with me in the public speaking area, not my most natural thing. And so there's a tremendous amount of fear that goes in every single week into me getting up here and preaching God's word for two reasons, really. One is that I don't want to fail God's word. The weight of the truth of the word of God is massive, and I do not want to fail to accurately preach and teach God's word. The other failure is more of a maybe even people-pleasing type of failure inside of that, is I don't want to fail you. I don't want you to walk away not transformed by the power of God's word, and I feel like if I fail in that area, then everything is lost and there is no hope, and I fear this every single week, every time I get up and preach. It's a real fear. I fear failure in my parenting, that I will fail my kids, my son and my daughter, and I won't do a good enough job. I will fail them in some way, and I fear failure in my marriage, that I'm going to somehow fail my wife, and I fear failure. It is a real fear that I have. It is my biggest fear. This is the type of fear that we're going to be talking about today. The deep-rooted, constant, sometimes crushing fear. And we have this, right? This is a room filled with people who fear something. Maybe your fear isn't the same as my fear. Maybe your fear isn't of failure. But maybe your fear is health, your health. Afraid. I mean, we just got done with 2 years, 3 years of some pretty fearful health things, right? Maybe your fear is losing loved ones. Maybe there's a fear of what's happening in our world today. Maybe there's a fear of abandonment or of rejection, or that we're afraid that people might see who we really are, right? There are so many fears that we have. And we're going to see what God's word has to say about this area of fear and how to overcome it. So Isaiah 43, 1 and 2. I'm going to read through it, and then we're going to go back phrase by phrase. Starting in verse 1, it says, "But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you." There's three things that we're going to grab from this passage today, and they are: even when I fail to walk, fear not. Even when I feel the weight, fear not, and even when I face the worst, fear not. We're going to take that first one. Even when I fail to walk, fear not. Even when I fail to walk, fear not. We need to go back and rewind to Isaiah 42, chapter 42, right before this in verse 18 and 25. It is describing the failure of Israel, Israel's massive problem with failure. In fact, in verse 24 of chapter 42, it says, "Was it not the Lord against whom you have sinned, in whose ways they would not walk, and whose law they would not obey?" In chapter 42, 18 through 25, we see that Israel failed. They're actually shown to be a couple of things. If you walk through that passage, they are shown to be deaf and blind and inattentive and falling short of the Lord's plan, that they are defeated and disobedient and spiritually unaware and apathetic towards the Lord. They have failed massively. And this isn't just unique to chapter 42. If you have read through the story of the nation of Israel, you know that over and over and over and over again, they have failed to walk in the Lord. They have wandered from the Lord, and then they come back to the Lord, and then they wander from the Lord, and then they come back to the Lord, and then they wander again, right? This is the story of Israel over and over. And this failure of Israel is not just unique to Israel, right? This is us too. In fact, some of the reasons why I love the nation of Israel so much in the scriptures is because I see myself so clearly in them, right? I'm like, man, I'm just like Israel. My affections towards the Lord wane, and I walk away, and then I come back, and then I walk away, and I mess up again, and I come back, and I fail, and I repent, and I fail, and I repent, right? This constant cycle. It's so relatable when we read about Israel and their failure, and we are the same. We fail. We fail. In many ways, we fail. And in that failure, we fear the consequences that come with that failure, right? We fear the consequences, whether they be earthly consequences, right? Like in my parenting, my kids might grow up and not know the Lord, or my spouse might leave, or I might get fired, or I might fail school, or I might ruin a relationship, or whatever it might be in the earthly sense. There's earthly consequences, but there's also eternal consequence, right? In our failure. That's the separation from God. Right? If you've ever heard someone say, like, man, I can't even walk into a church. If I walked into a church, I would be smitten by the Lord, right? We think about we're afraid of these eternal consequences, and we fear the consequences, and so we fear the failure. The end of chapter 42 is directly related to chapter 43. It's directly related. It's like a continuation of 42. And so we start verse 1, says, "But now, thus says the Lord," or "now then" is another way to translate that, "but now." "Now then, says the Lord." All of that failure that took place, how is God going to respond to that? Is he going to smite Israel? Is he going to pour out his judgment and wrath over Israel for all of their failure and all of their sin? He starts with, "He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel." God is establishing himself right here. He's establishing himself as the ultimate, right? He created you. He formed you. He is the ultimate. He has all of the authority, all of the power. He is God who created and formed you. When I read verses like this in the scripture where God reminds the people that he created and formed them, I'm always reminded of that old saying that parents used to tell kids. Do you know where I'm going with this already? "I brought you into the world, and I can take you out of it," right? It's like this empty thread of, like, you better stop what you're doing, right? I feel like when God does this, he's like, hey, listen, remember, I created you. I formed you. Who has all of the authority? Me. Who has all of the power? Me. This is God. He is establishing his authority with the nation. He created and formed them. But it's not just the authority. It's not just the power. It's also him establishing this personal relationship with Israel. He created and formed them. He knows them. He knows us. Inside and out, God knows us intimately because he created and formed us. And so instead of being smited or brought into judgment or wrath, God has such a sweet word and promise here. It says, "Fear not," followed by three statements. "For I have redeemed you, I have called you by name, you are mine." The "I have redeemed you" is literally saved. I have delivered you. I have saved you. I have redeemed you from both earthly consequences, right? Israel was beset by nations and dire circumstances, and God delivered them from those things, but also eternal consequences. Sin and separation from God, hell, eternity, right? He has delivered and redeemed. He then says, "I have called you by name." This is that intimacy. He knows them by name, this personal connection. He has chosen them. I think a lot of times we think of God in the, we think about God two ways. We think about him in his transcendence and in his immanence. His transcendence is that he is set apart, holy, other, perfect, holy, so far above us that we can't even comprehend. And so we are in reverent fear of the Lord our God, right? Transcendent. But the amazing thing about God is that he is also immanent. He is personal. And he has created and formed you and knows you. And he calls you his. He says, "You are mine." This is an identity statement. He is claiming ownership over his people. These are very specific words for a very specific people. His people. His people. And this speaks to our identity in God because we are his people. We are his. We have been redeemed, saved. We are his. The one who created the universe and holds it together. We are intimately his, and he has redeemed us. That is yours and my identity in Christ Jesus. And here's the thing is, without that identity, without that reality, that truth, we have no hope in our fear. Without that identity, we have no hope in our consequences. Without that identity, our failures or our sins, it means death. But for those who do have that identity in God, we have hope in the face of our fear. We have a new identity, for he has called us by name. He says, "You are mine. I have redeemed you. I have saved you." This reminds me of when I was younger, we lived in a developing subdivision. And when they would build a new house, what would happen is they would dig out, right? Because they would be laying the foundation for the home. And so this, all of a sudden, this giant pile of dirt would show up in the subdivision, in the place where they were going to build the house. And so as young kids, we were like, this is the greatest thing ever. Right, it is literally like a 20-foot tall pile of dirt. What better use of our time than to go and play on that, right? And so we did. We would get all the neighborhood boys and girls together, and we would go and play on the dirt hill, right? And I remember one time, my dad was outside, and I'm like, "Dad, I'm going to go play on the hill." And he's like, "All right, be safe," you know. typical dad. Tucked in his shirt, slicked back his hair. It's amazing. So like he was outside. And so we did. We were playing on the mound, and I think it was a construction worker or someone who maybe owned the property or something. They ended up coming, and they were not too pleased that we were playing on their dirt hill. They were quite upset that we were doing that, which in retrospect, now that I'm an adult, that makes sense, right? And so he comes up and he starts yelling at us, and he's really upset with us, and we're just, you know, silly kids, and we're like, "Oh, I don't know what's happening." Anyway, so my dad comes over, he hears all the commotion, and he comes over and he yells out to me. He says, "Tommy, come here," right? And okay, it's my dad. I come over, and I remember, I don't exactly remember what was said between the adult and my dad, but I remember my dad saying this exact phrase. He said, "It's fine. This is my son." And then we walked back home. And I remember in that moment, I was so fearful of this adult, right, who was yelling at us. And I'm like, what are the consequences? He said something about calling the cops. I was freaking out, you know. And then all of a sudden, my dad comes in and he calls me by name. Tommy, come here. And then he tells that other person that I was his. This is my son. And in that moment, something happened where I was no longer afraid. I no longer feared the situation because my dad was there. And he called me my name, and I knew whose I was. And he saved me from that situation. Our God does infinitely more than that for us. Infinitely more than that for us. He saves us from the consequences of our failure. Let's take our biggest failure, sin. No matter what you have done in your life, if you think of your biggest failure as a person, the actual largest failure that you have done is sinning against God. That is your and my biggest failure in our life, is sin towards our Creator. And it comes with the most serious of consequences, the worst consequence, which is separation and hell. And listen to me, there's some realities about God in this passage that are so important for us to hold on to, because God shows himself to be three things in this passage. One of those things is he is powerful. He shows himself to be powerful. He has redeemed us, saved us from our greatest failure and our greatest consequence. He has saved us from sin and the consequence of sin, which is hell, separation forever. He is powerful. And so if God can save us from sin and hell, our greatest failure and consequence, certainly he can save us from our small failures of everyday life and the consequences that come with it. Amen? He is powerful. He also shows himself to be personal. Shows himself to be personal. I have called you by name. He is a personal God, immanent with us, the God of the universe. And he shows himself to be possessive. You are mine. We are his. And listen to me, if we are God's children, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the all-powerful one, what do we have to fear? We are his, and he is possessive over us. So for those whose identity is in God, this is our reality. And so I think we need to ask the question, is my identity in God? Is this true of me? If it's not, you can make that happen today. You can, the scripture says that if you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, you confess with your mouth that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You can have that identity today, placing your faith and trust in Jesus. So even when I fail to walk, because he is powerful, personal, and possessive, fear not. Here's the second thing. Let's look at verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. Second thing that we see is that even when I feel the weight, fear not. We get two images here, one of the waters and one of the rivers. The waters could be reminding the people of Israel of Moses and the Red Sea, and God bringing them through the water. You remember the story? They've escaped Egypt, and Pharaoh is coming after them with his army intent on crushing them and overwhelming them and overtaking them. And they come against the Red Sea, and they are stuck between the sea and the army. And the army is coming in, but God makes a way for Israel, parts the Red Sea. Israel goes across on dry ground. They make it across, and then God closes the sea on the Egyptians as they pursue. That's one of the images that we see here, the waters. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Then we have the rivers. This is probably imagery of the Jordan River. Every year, the Jordan River would swell. In a specific season, in a rainy season, it would swell, it would become overflowing. And in that time period, it would be difficult to cross. It would be dangerous to cross the Jordan River because of how powerful it was moving. It was overwhelming, right? When I went fishing with my dad, we used to do something called fly fishing. Does anyone know? Everyone knows what fly fishing is? It's where you kind of stand in a river and you have this weird rod and you're flicking it back and forth trying to get some huge fish. And I remember being in that river, and it's the first time that I ever was able to walk in a river. It's not just something that I did often. And I remember one area of the river that was really rough, was flowing really fast. And I just remember getting in and feeling the pressure of the water. And maybe you felt this in a different area. Maybe you've been in the ocean and you felt the waves of the ocean press against you and move you, right? In a river, it's the same thing. It's you feel this weight of the water that's rushing at you. And it can feel overwhelming. That's the fear here, is the fear is of being overwhelmed. Israel has been overwhelmed. They have faced this fear many times through war and through exile and through life circumstances, these overwhelming situations. What are you overwhelmed by? What are the things in your life that feel just absolutely overwhelming? They feel like a massive weight on you. Maybe it's parenting, keeping up with the kids and making sure that you're doing the best that you can and caring for them, and maybe it's that. Maybe you feel overwhelmed. Maybe it's work, just so busy all the time. I feel like I don't have time for anything else. I'm feeling so weighted down and feeling so overwhelmed. Maybe it's relationships. Maybe they're taking so much emotion from you, right? I'm not physically overwhelmed. I'm not spiritually overwhelmed, but I am emotionally overwhelmed. Maybe it's a trauma from your past. Maybe it's a different life circumstance, but it just feels like weight, like pressure. Like you're standing in the midst of a raging river and you can't move forward. And it feels like it could overtake you at any moment. I don't know if I'm going to make it. I'm just so overwhelmed. God gives us two things here, two amazing things. One is that he gives his presence. You notice? When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. He gives us his presence. He is with you. I love Psalm 23, verse 4. It says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. In this verse, we are the sheep. We're the silly, kind of dumb sheep, right? If you know anything about sheep, you know that they're a bit goofy, right? They're not very smart animals. And they tend, have you ever seen that video, by the way, of like the guy saving the sheep from that long trench, pulls them out, and then it runs, and then it jumps right back into it? Yeah, like, I'm like, yeah, no, I've done that. Been there, done that, right? We are the sheep in this, and God is our good shepherd. And with his rod and his staff, he comforts us. He is with us. The rod in this passage signifies God's strength and his protection against danger and animals. Shepherds would have a shepherd's rod, which if they were attacked by wolves or dangerous animals, they would fight them off. They would also have a staff, and the staff symbolized their guidance, their loving kindness. They would lead the sheep, keeping them from falling off cliffs and keeping them from going astray. He would lead and guide the sheep, and just like them, God does that with us, with his rod and his staff. He guides us and leads us with his loving kindness. He is strong and protective over us. He is with us, his presence. The other thing is a promise. It says, you will not be overwhelmed. When you go through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. You will not be overwhelmed. It's going to feel heavy at times, certainly, but it will not overwhelm you. You might be thinking, but I feel overwhelmed. You don't understand. I'm already feeling this. I am feeling the just overwhelmed, absolutely weighed down. Yep. We're going to feel the weight. But it will not overtake you. It will not completely overwhelm you. God is with you, leading you and guiding you, and his strength is with you. And so instead of fear, because we have such a wonderful, good shepherd who is with us, we can actually, instead of fear, we can feel comfort. His rod and staff, they comfort me. So even when I feel the weight, he is present and his promises are true, so I can fear not. Here's the last thing. Let's look at verse 2 again, 2b. It says, when you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. Here's the third thing. Even when I face the worst, fear not. Even when I face the worst, fear not. Again, we have some imagery here of fire and flames. In fact, we see a perfect example of this verse lived out, played out in Daniel chapter 3. Verses 25 or 24, it says, because the king's order was urgent. If you remember the story, a little backstory, there's these three guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they were worshipers of God. And they were in this kingdom, and the king wanted them to bow down and worship a golden statue, right? They wanted them to worship the statue of the king, and they refused to do so. They didn't do it. And so they were then threatened with violence, with death, actually. If you're not going to bow down to the idol, to the false god, then you are going to be put to death. And they said, you know, that's fine with us. Our God will save us, and even if he doesn't, we will not bow down to you. And so, because they didn't bow down to the king and the idol, they were thrown into the fiery furnace. We pick up, he says, because the king's order was urgent and the furnace was overheated, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The flame is so hot, this fire is so moving that it killed the people who opened the furnace. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell bound into the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished and rose up in haste. He declared to his counselors, did we not cast three men bound into the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. He answered and said, but I see four men unbound, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt. And the appearance of the fourth is like the son of the gods. And the satraps and the prefects and the governors and the king's counselors gathered together and saw that the fire had not had any power over the bodies of those men. The hair of their heads was not singed. Their cloaks were not harmed, and no smell of fire had come upon them. Do you see how perfect of an example this is in the scriptures? These men were sentenced to the worst, death by a fiery furnace. And yet they walked through the fire and the flame, and they were not burned, and it did not consume them. It didn't harm a single strand of hair on their head. It didn't harm their clothing. They were completely protected by God, who was with them. They faced the worst, and it did not consume them. Now, Daniel was written after Isaiah. So Isaiah, when he's saying this, is probably not referring to Daniel. It's probably referring to what the Israelites would know of this imagery of fire, which would be probably a military conquest. It would be an image of like cities burning, being destroyed, being lit aflame. Truly facing the worst, right? Utter destruction of these places through fire. We use that expression a lot, don't we? That's the worst, right? We use, and I think maybe better yet to say, we misuse that phrase a lot. We say that's the worst, right? For things that really aren't like the worst, you know what I mean? Pineapple on pizza, we're like, that's the worst. Is it? Some of you are like, yeah, no, it's the worst. Is it the worst though? right? Some people say it about traffic. Traffic is the worst. It's the worst. It's the worst. It's the worst thing. When you're trying to watch like a TV show on Netflix and it won't load and the little circle just keeps, you know what I'm talking about? We're like, this is the worst. Yeah. Mosquitoes, obviously the worst, right? We're coming into the season, guys. Get ready for the worst. Or how about, I was at the movie theater watching the Super Mario Brothers movie with my son a couple weeks ago, and we went up to the ticket counter, and I was like, hey, two tickets to Super Mario Brothers. They're like, pick your seat, and I tried to touch it, and they're like, that's not a touch screen. I'm like, that's awful. I'll pick those seats then. And then she said, all right, here's your ticket. Enjoy your movie. And I said, you too. And I was like, oh, man, that is the worst when you do that, right? That is the worst. Maybe you came in today and one of the guys wished you Happy Mother's Day and you're like, you too. Oh, no. Right? We overuse that statement. That's the worst. But this is talking about the literal worst, right? This isn't talking about those minor inconveniences that we say are the worst. This is talking about the actual worst, the literal worst thing. Think about that in your life, because I want to make sure that we understand this promise, is that there is a magnificent promise for us, but we need to understand it. This promise means that we have to go through the fire. You see it in there? It says, when you walk through the fire, when you walk through the flame, you have to go through it. It's not just a swerve around the fire. It's not a removal of the fire. You still have to walk through the fire. The promise of God in this is that when we do that, when we walk through the fire, and we will, and some people's fires might be hotter than others, God's promise is that when you go through it, it won't burn you. It's not going to consume you. It is not going to destroy you, even though it might feel that way in the moment. And it might be the most difficult thing that you've ever had to walk through. His promise is that it won't destroy you. It won't consume you. He will protect you. He will help you persevere. You will make it through protected. That's the promise. When you face the worst, God is with you and is protecting you. James chapter 1 says, verse 2, count it all joy, my brothers and sisters, when you meet trials of various kinds. Trials, hardship, the worst. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Trials, hardship produces steadfastness, and when it has its full effect, when we persevere through, we are complete, lacking in nothing. In other words, it builds our faith. It builds up our faith. So when another moment of fear, when another moment of hardship comes against us, when we walk through it, our faith has been built in the fire before, because we saw God do an incredible work in us and through us. And so when we go through something else, we look back at that moment and we say, I can trust God. He has built my faith in that moment in the fire, and I can trust him now to protect me going forward. It builds our faith, and when we face hardship again, we remember the faithfulness of God. We go through it knowing that God is faithful and he will get us through. So something really practical I think about facing things that are the worst is to stop trying to control it and to trust the Lord. Stop trying to control it and trust the Lord. When bad things happen, when hard things happen, we try as hard as we can to make that better. We try planning things and doing, we try whatever we can. We white knuckle it. I have to change this. I have to fix this. I have to do this. Listen, we can't walk through fire and flames and just plan on not getting burned. We can't walk through fire and flames, and if we just work hard enough, we won't get burned and consumed by it. There's nothing that we can do to fix the situations of the worst moments. But we can trust the Lord and his protection over us, because he's done it before and he can do it again. And so when I face the worst, he is my protection, and so I fear not. Zion last night was in the tub, and he like called me from downstairs, and I came up and I'm like, hey, what's up, bud? And he is like, Dad, I'm just really afraid right now. He had watched something like a week ago at his grandmother's house, and the narrator of the show had a really deep and scary voice. And so I know the fears of eight-year-olds. Can you know? I wish we had those fears, right? And he was afraid of the voice, and it was in his head. And he goes, Dad, how do I get rid of the fear? And I was like, wow, this is like, huh? I just am writing a sermon about that. So let's see. Let's see how effective the sermon is. And so I told him, got to practice it last night. He said, how do I get rid of my fear? I said, well, son, you do it with the truth. You get rid of your fear with the truth, because truth unpacks the lie of fear, that God isn't in control, that God isn't going to protect you, that God doesn't care about you, that God isn't with you, right? And then we become fearful, and the truth unpacks the lie. The lie seems huge and big and massive, but as you remember the truths and the promises of God, it slowly chips away at that lie. It unpacks it and makes it tiny and small and vulnerable. And so I said, son, you do it with the truth. You remember what God says, that he is with you, that he is watching you, that he is protecting you. And we prayed. And he's like, thanks, Dad, I feel better. I'm like, all right, sermon's at least okay. You know, it's like... Because what do we have to fear, church? What do we have to fear when we know the truth that our God is powerful and personal and possessive and present and protecting, and his promises are true? What do we have to fear? Fear not, for he is with you. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word. We thank you that you know us so well. You know that we are fearful people and that we are afraid of so many things. And you tell us over and over and over again in your word to fear not, but to trust you and to trust your character and to trust your goodness. And so, Lord, would you help us with that? It's really hard because we face situations that seem overwhelming and difficult, and they hurt, and we are sometimes believing the lie and just overwhelmed with fear. And so, God, I just pray that you would speak your true word over us, that you would remind us of your promises, that we would hold and keep these things in our heart. And when fear rears its ugly head, we would use those truths to unpack that lie of fear. Lord, do a work in us. We're thankful for your word. Thank you, Lord, for our wonderful mothers. We're so excited to celebrate them today, and we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.